Hello, everybody. Welcome. It's me, Peaches Christ.
And it's me, Heklina.
And we are here to host the online memorial for our dear friend Peggy L'eggs, also known as Matthew Simmons. And of course, we would much prefer to be gathering in person right now to celebrate this extraordinary friend. But I guess doing it virtually is the next best thing. We want to thank SF Oasis for hosting the memorial today. That's where Heklina and I are beaming out to you from, and especially Drunk Drag Broadway, who put the tech setup for this all together, Sean Frank and China Make It. Thank you so much. We wanted to be able to do something to bring the community together. And to get things started, we're both going to share a little bit about Peggy and what she meant to us. Heklina?
Oh, hi. Peggy is somebody, I first met when she started performing at Tranny Shack, and I immediately saw that she was something special, and she was so talented. I actually took her on tour with me. She did shows with me in Seattle, in Los Angeles, in Portland, and even Fresno. So, she was somebody that I always liked to work with, and she was always supportive, which was something that I know I always was too. So we were like kindred spirits because we were both very giving and kind people. So I really, really want to remember her because we were very similar that way. Peaches?
Yes. I met Peggy back when Heklina did, and correct me if I'm wrong, Heklina, but there was a night where I think Peggy was in town from Canada as a special guest performer, and we did the dating game, or you did the dating game?
It was a night that Renteca wanted to do the dating game, and she had Peggy do that.
Yeah, and I remember looking at Peggy and really being jealous of how pretty she was. You know, she had those big eyes and the cheekbones and the face, she was gorgeous. And I didn't actually meet her in person until she moved to San Francisco and started performing more regularly with us at the Stud. And it was shortly after that that she began performing at Midnight Mass over at the Bridge Theater way back when.
Pepper Spray.
Oh, well, of course, Pepper Spray.
Yeah.
It was Peggy immediately kind of jumped into the performing scene here, both as Matthew and as Peggy. And I mean, I don't think there was anyone who disliked Peggy. To this day, if someone dislikes Peggy, they're really a fucked up.
They dislike life.
Yeah.
And they dislike kittens and cotton candy.
Something is, very, very wrong with them.
They don't like chocolate.
Everyone loved Peggy.
Yeah.
And she was, pretty early on, someone who became a dear friend and part of my chosen family. I have so, so many memories, actually too many memories to actually start to dive into them.
Tell them all to us right now.
I won't tell you all of them, but I will tell you this. Something that Peggy consistently did that I both loved and it also drove me crazy was that she didn't have, how should I say it? She didn't have the most respect for a script or direction, let's say. So I would, in rehearsals, really kind of, I think you should do this and you should do that. And we'd get out on stage for the actual show and you never knew what she was going to do. I mean, she really, truly would go rogue. And more times than not, I was okay with it, the audience always loved it, which made it very hard to be mad at her, later, because the audience loved Peggy. She would steal scenes left and right. There was a showgirl show that a lot of us did together where Peggy came out, and it was as if she had never read the script. It was like, I didn't know where the words were coming from. I actually stopped and turned to the audience and said, Peggy, are you gonna ever do anything on the script? And we had a little bit of a thing on stage. Of course, for her, it was hilarious, and she had the audience eating out of the palm of her hands. For me, I just had to kind of get over it.
You were outraged.
I was outraged for a few days. It's true. But who can be, who can stay mad at Peggy, you know?
Actually, you know what? I got mad at Peggy once.
Did you?
Yes. So Peggy was a fierce advocate of bowel movements. Oh. And what I mean by that is she wasn't shy about it. Mm-hmm. And one of the first times I met her, she was at my studio apartment in the Tenderloin, little tiny studio, and she was taking a dump. And she had the door open, and I said, "What are you doing?" And I was like making fun of her for taking a dump, and she said, "You know what, Heklina? I'm gonna buy you a book. It's called Everybody Poops." And she did. I have that book, Everybody Poops, to this day.
And did
and
you?
And Peggy was very wise.
Heklina, you were at the memorial that her fabulous family put together. Some of us met at the wave pool. And her niece actually said that Peggy used to read Everyone Poops
to her.
You
see what I mean? She was really into spreading the fact that pooping is normal.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, I mean, there's so many reasons I love Peggy. Not to... all the performances we did together, she actually became part of my Thanksgiving tradition. Peggy would come and spend Thanksgiving with us every year, and she'd always make a really trashy green bean casserole. I will definitely be missing that this November. And more than anything, more than the performances, the casserole, all of that, I'll miss just her total love. She was a lover. She made you feel like she was always completely invested in what you were doing, what you had to say, and when the shit would hit the fan or I would feel shitty or I'd be upset, that was the person I wanted around me. You know, she was wonderful.
She was also like the kind of like the crazy aunt, the crazy drag aunt, like the Aunt Clara, if you know the show Bewitched. She always, when she came to any of our shows, she brought a box of See's chocolates. And I guess I want to thank her for that.
But it's true, like, no one else does that, right? Like, in our scene, Peggy would not only call me up and invite me to a show, she would say, "And girl, let's not ask for passes, let's buy the tickets, you know, so we can support the project." Like, Heklina doesn't do that, and she's very wealthy.
Wait a minute,
know?
Peggy always asked me for free tickets.
Because you're very wealthy.
But I gave them to her because she always showed up with chocolates.
She did, yes. Yeah. And she just, I mean, we all know and love the way Peggy dressed as Matthew, with the bow ties and the, I mean, it's just the smiles and the love and the generosity. Now, if you've read the fabulous obituary that the Bay Area Reporter put out, you'll know that Peggy, when we say that she lived a rich life, it's an understatement. Not only did she do all of the shows that we're talking about and participate in all of the communities, she also worked a full-time job, basically caring for people over at the fantastic organization, the Shanti Project. And she like had hobbies and was a musician and so on and so forth. So this memorial that we're doing today is only going to scratch the surface of what Matthew Simmons really was and could do and what his life was all about. We don't have enough time to really get to everything. That's how rich her life was. So we have contacted a number of people to represent different parts of her life at different times and different things that she's done. But again, if you weren't included or you knew Peggy, we encourage you to share your stories after this memorial and the reception that's being hosted by Kylie Minogue. We want everyone to join us over there after the memorial on Zoom so that you can share your stories and we can all participate in remembering Peggy together.
And donate, right? You can donate to Shanti.
Well, that's the other thing is, you know, we are asking folks who are interested in making a donation in Peggy's name to do that. And there is actually going to be a link that we'll share, but it's very easy to find out where to donate to the Shanti Project. Just search them online. I believe it's shantiproject.org. And you can, oh, here it is, shanti.org/Matthew-Simmons. So you can make that donation in her name right now or today or tonight.
Do a screen capture right now.
Yeah, and then, you know, because that organization, not only did Peggy work for them, she also brought a lot of us in. So Peggy brought me to the Shanti Project, and you know, 10 years ago when we started doing shows at the Castro Theater, we made the Shanti Project our beneficiary for fundraisers. And it was an organization that meant a lot to her because of the incredible work they did helping people who needed help when they were sick and dying. And she was an angel to so many of us there and beyond. So it's a wonderful place to make a donation in her honor. Now, should we start with some of these memorial?
Oh, who's up first, Peaches?
Well, we're gonna go back to kind of, you know, the pre-Peggy, you know. Before there was Peggy, there was Matthew, the budding actor who was doing drama in high school. And we've got two friends of his, lifelong friends, who were friends with Matthew back in high school, Mark Grissini and Mindy Cordett.
Yay!
You know, connecting, zooming.
How you feeling?
I am okay. Ready to do this.
Okay.
And I think let's just try to, you know, go through those photos one by one. I'm gonna pull up that file and see how it goes here. Then I'm gonna share the screen. Sorry for this, it's like,
oh, please don't be sorry.
Technology.
Okay, is there so going to be like, I'm the prettiest of all? In
you've always been the prettiest of all. So yes. Let's just start with this picture here. so that's my freshman year. And the first time I was ever on stage, and I was on stage with Matthew. And of course he was doing, you know, his subtle, low emotional sort of, you know, stuff that he does.
As his work is, yes.
Yeah, but that's a pipe in my mouth. It's just a bad picture, but yeah, Matt, you could always count on Matt for a little comedy.
What was that show? Oh, there's us. Look how serious we are.
Well, you were acting. What did you say about this performance?
This was the best high school performance of Guinevere and Arthur in the history of all high schools. Look at that.
The history of all high schools.
Well, you can see.
Yeah, and then the three of us not ready for prime time. I think Matt looks like an absolute stud here.
He looks great. Look at him.
He looks great. And all three of us do.
We look good.
What a bunch of angels. Oh, this was a skit for one of the Glee Club things, one of the Pep Fest things. And Matt was always front and center for those.
Oh, my God.
A baby, but cute.
Look at that hair. Oh, that's San Francisco when we met in the middle of the center. Oh, look at, that's my favorite picture. I love that picture. And I was so happy.
And that was right by your aunt's place, wasn't it?
Yep. Uh-huh. Yep. He worked two blocks away from my aunt. Both places she lived, he had offices within two blocks. Oh.
And then this was one of the first times we got together as a group after a few years being apart.
Oh, look at how we look good. I think we look good. He's really handsome. Look at him. I love his looks.
I loved how happy he always looked when we got together.
Yeah.
You know? And this is not a great picture, but I mean, there's so much love in that picture, I can't even stand it.
That was right after Peter died. That was the first one.
He was an amazing source of comfort in times in our lives that we really needed him.
Yep.
Just loved him dearly.
Oh.
And then this was that Christmas dinner. And of course he's setting the table and, you know, everything is
perfect.
You know, everything's perfect. Everything's everything is a show.
This.
And funny, everything was just funny. And then,
oh my God.
This is the same picture from that
Christmas.
That same Christmas.
There's his bow tie.
And he was consistent in the way that, I mean, he always loved us. He always let us know. I'd like to offer our sincere condolences to his brothers, Stan and Chris, his nieces, nephews, his cousins, and his extended family, and for his many friends around the country. Thank you so much for sharing Matt with us.
No, I'm welling up now.
God bless and take care of yourself.
I loved seeing those old photos. My God. And we were commenting last night that, like, her physicality really hasn't changed. If you look at those old photos from back in high school, she still strikes those poses, you know, like, I feel like she was instantly recognizable, even as a young Matthew.
That was just beautiful, you guys. Those memories. I love that.
Heklina, we have...
Oh, what?
It's your job now. Well, we did want to mention... My God. She does have a job to do, but she just, I guess, was forgetting. So one thing that we wanted to mention to you guys is that Heklina and I... As also, you know, being of the same family.
Oh, God.
We are in the...
Oh, God.
What?
Because people are going to judge us if we don't tell them this.
Right.
That's right. I forgot.
So we are in a COVID bubble together.
Before you Corona Connies and Pandemic Paulines judge us, your Epidemic Emmys.
Yeah.
I want you to know that Peaches and I have been attached at the hip this entire pandemic.
Yes.
So we're sharing the same bacteria.
Right. So we just wanted to make that clear in case anyone, you know, was concerned. So I think we are going to move right along. We do have a lot of videos and testimonials and some folks who are going to speak live. So let's introduce our next speaker, Heckles.
All right. It is... he spoke beautifully at the memorial.
So nice.
So nice. So great to and I don't want to say he, I'll say they, because I don't want to assume pronouns either. They were very eloquent at the memorial. Please give it up for Peggy's dear friend, Cayenne.
I want to tell a story of a time almost three decades ago in the 90s when I first met Matthew. We first became friends. It was before his fevered imagination had come up with the whole character of Peggy L'eggs. And he was just beginning his career, as he called it, as a gender illusionist. So he had a character called Audrey. And Audrey would appear every once in a while. Audrey was a beauty queen wannabe. She entered every pageant. She had the entire regalia, the gown, the tiara, the sash. Audrey was a trooper. Audrey was determined to be a winner. But Audrey did have some challenges. She couldn't afford cosmetic dentistry, so her teeth were a little bit off. And she often had mysterious injuries, like a cervical neck collar, her arm in a sling, but that's okay, it never slowed her down. Audrey was gonna be a winner. So it was Gay Pride Month, sometime in the 90s, and Audrey wanted to be in the Gay Pride Day parade because she knew that the gays were gonna love Audrey and they were gonna be her biggest fans. So she had a business manager slash boyfriend named Rocky, and Rocky was given the job of renting a convertible and a little tuxedo so that Audrey could ride in the Gay Pride Day parade. So Rocky did great. He got the tuxedo, but when it came to the car, he waited a little too long. And when he went to rent the convertible, there were none left because all the drag queens in the parade had rented all the convertibles. So instead, he rented a hand truck. You know, the little kind that you push, that, you know, you move a refrigerator. It had little hard rubber wheels. And Audrey, being the trooper that she was going to ride in the Gay Pride Day parade on the hand truck. So back in the 90s, this was when you could still sort of inject yourself in between two official contingents in the Gay Pride Day parade without causing a security meltdown. So there we were on Spear Street, right at the beginning of the parade, with our hand truck, me in the tuxedo, Audrey in all of her regalia. And came time to sneak in the parade, and off we went around the corner onto Market Street, and there was Audrey on the hand truck, and she's jiggling along, one arm in a sling, little clutch purse, just happy and smiling at the crowd, and it was really adorable. With the asphalt, gah, 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 gah. And then, unplanned, accidentally, Rocky pushed the hand truck into the Muni streetcar track trough, jammed the hand truck, and Audrey flew off the hand truck, hit the asphalt, face plant, little Tiara rolling in the street, and of course the crowd was like, oh! And then Audrey picked herself up, you know, winner that she is, and climbed back on the hand truck, put her tiara back on, waved her hand, smiled, and off we went down Martin Street. Now, she's riding along like this, and of course, Matthew being the consummate clown, trained dancer, skilled improviser, he's going like, push me faster, faster, hit the track, hit the track. So, sure enough, on purpose this time, I hit the track, and boom, she goes flying. Just the most spectacular pratfall, crashes to the street, little compact rolls out of her clutch purse, drops into the grid over the bar track, and again, the crowd's like, oh! And then she climbs up and climbs back on the truck, and off we go, and everybody just fell out. So this was such a hit that we did it over and over again, the entire length of the parade. We would wait several hundred feet till we were out of visual range of the previous pratfall, and then do it again. And it was, of course, hard to push her and to do all that, but the hardest part was to not laugh, because it was so hysterical every time. So we went all the way to the end of the parade, and then at the end, I was completely exhausted, soaked to the skin, and to this day, it was probably the most fun I have ever had. So that was the dazzle. And now, I just want to say that for almost 30 years, I enjoyed the most amazing friendship with someone who could actually provide me with unconditional love. How often does anyone get to say that? Especially from someone so dazzling and so brilliant. And I say it in all humility, because there's no way I could ever reciprocate the level of kindness and affection and forgiveness that she afforded me. It's been an amazing experience, for which I will always be eternally grateful. So there's the dazzle and the depth. That was our Peggy. And I want to finish by borrowing something from Pepper Spray. And I want to say, we love you, Peggy. Oh, yes, we do. We don't love anyone as much as you.
Thank you, Kyan. That was wonderful.
That was beautiful.
Very. Yeah, we were remembering that, you know, many of Peggy's early performances, she loved to use teeth, like fake teeth or crutches or a neck brace. Do you remember she used to have like something that she'd put in her mouth and stretch her
Yes,
face?
She did that song by Pink Martini. They did a version of Que Sera Sera.
Yes.
And that's what she did.
And I guess she got it at the dentist. And then last year when we did our Terror Vault show together, she played Grandma, and she came
Very
in with...
Very disturbing,
she,
yes.
Yeah, she basically took home the dental apparatus that they used to stretch her mouth open, and she put her makeup on all around that. So she really knew how to use, I guess, teeth prosthetics. Yeah, very creative. Now, this next person, speaking of brilliant makeup and prosthetics and talent.
Right here, Peaches.
Yeah. So I'm going to introduce this next person who is a wonderful friend. And I had the...
I'm right here.
I had the pleasure of actually getting to introduce these two because Joel King, the brilliant makeup artist, was doing makeup at Peaches Christ Productions. And... we would often put Peggy with Joel, and Joel would do Peggy's makeup for shows. And they became friendly, and so much so that over time, as Joel started performing and became Vanilla Meringue, winner of Star Search, former Miss Star Search, it was Peggy who was Vanilla's drag mother. And in the drag world, you know, it's a special thing to have a drag mom who holds your hand and helps guide you. And I know Peggy absolutely thought the world of Vanilla and would love this next performance, which Vanilla has created, dedicated to Peggy.
Hi,
I look up to the little bird that glides across the sky. He sings the clearest melody. It makes me want to cry. Yeah. It makes me want to sit right down and cry. Yeah. A book along the city street. I wish that I could be that bird and fly away from here. I wish I had the wings to fly away from here, yeah. But mama, I feel so low, mama. Said that you knew best, but this little bird's fallen out of that nest. Now I've got a feeling that it might have been blessed, so I've just got to put these wings to test. Wow.
That was gorgeous. Give it up for Vanilla Meringue, everybody.
So beautiful.
A loving tribute to her drag mother, Peggy L'eggs.
You're introducing
do I go right into it?
Well, I mean, or you could, you know, make small talk. I mean, you know, yeah.
Oh, you know, it's so long since I've actually emceed any kind of a show. I kind of forgot how to do
it. You forgot, yeah.
So, well, small talk. Well, as you know, your wish has come true, Peaches. I'm leaving San Francisco.
That's not my wish.
Your wish is for me to be dead.
Oh, my God, no. I wish you would give me some money.
Well, that wish is never going to come true.
I know.
Well, yes, I'm leaving tomorrow. No, I'm picking up the U-Haul tomorrow, and I'm going to be packing the U-Haul van tomorrow, so I know you're going to come by and help me load up the van with all my wigs and dresses.
Absolutely. I wouldn't miss it.
And then I leave on Monday. So, yes, I'll be back in San Francisco as soon as Miss Rona goes away. But, oh my God, now I'm going to introduce a bunch of nerds. Get this, Peaches.
Yeah.
Peggy was in a book club.
A book club?
Yeah. Nerd alert!
Oh my God.
I know.
What drag queen is in a book club?
What next? Dungeons and Dragons? Am I right?
Hello.
Nerds, hello. So anyway, they have a little video they want to...
It's called the Fierce Read Book Club.
Yeah. Give it up for the Fierce Read Book Club. Bunch of nerds.
Hello, my name is Joshua, and I am a very active member of the Fierce Read Book Club, although I've been in and out. And I wanted to introduce you to the book club where we got to enjoy reading many books with Matthew/Peggy. We have Paulina here. Elizabeth, the fantastic Timmy Spence. You can wave, Timmy. Okay, perfect. Corey.
I just did.
Oh, thank you, Timmy. Corey, aka Corky. And Michael, also known as Martini. Okay, so we're going to share a little bit. This book club was born out of all of us kind of knowing each other through Midnight Mass and working together at the Bridge Theater. And performing together. And so basically all of us here worked at the Bridge Theater except for Timmy at one point or another. And so we probably started this book club over 20 years ago, right? I don't know, maybe over 20 years ago?
Yes.
And mm-hmm. Peggy was a member of it for probably what, 15 years? I don't know. Anyway, mm-hmm. So we'll start with Paulina.
Hi. You know, I got to know Peggy through the book club, and I had, you know, sort of been in and out of it since its beginning. In the middle, just sort of life took me in and out. But when I rejoined about 6 or 7 years ago is when I got to know Peggy, and just instantly it was as if we'd known each other forever. I mean, she just, as so many people have said in these past couple weeks, one of the kindest people I'd ever known. A big heart, super funny, and just always really welcoming to me, you know, no matter the circumstance. And, you know, we would come together every couple months to discuss a book and sort of everything else in between. And I just enjoyed her company so much. And I just feel really, really lucky that, you know, to have this group over so many years, and it has brought together some of my favorite people. And, you know, Peggy was one of them. And I just feel so lucky to have had this kind of experience with her and to have gotten to know her through books and through words and through, you know, Midnight Mass and the Bridge Theater and all of it. So, yeah, she just was a real light and always will be to me.
Thanks. And Elizabeth, do you have a remembrance?
I first met Peggy at Midnight Mass. We were doing the Annie show, and this was the year 2000, I think just 20 years ago. She was the star. She was playing Annie, and I was in the chorus. And it was such tremendous fun. And she was so amazingly funny and talented. And I just kept thinking, who is this person? Why didn't I know her before? And then later on, after, I didn't know this at the time because I was on the stage with her, but afterwards, my friends told me that she, during her performance, she was not wearing any underwear. So she had given to the audience the beautiful gift of her dancing privates. And that to me really sums up Peggy. She was just so generous, so giving, so funny, so warm, so kind. And she always read the book.
Ooh, that was a dig.
That was a read, yeah.
A read.
Yeah, that's why it's the fear to read.
Paulson, I think you were the only one who wore underwear in that show.
I think that's questionable. I don't know.
Well, one thing I should mention regarding Elizabeth's story is the brilliant thing about Peggy not wearing underwear in our Annie show was that she didn't tell any of us, including myself, who was the director of that show. And Peggy and I actually co-wrote that show. She never told me that she was going to take off her panties and her underwear. And when she did cartwheels as Annie across the stage, her junk was flopping around. And that's when we all discovered that Peggy wasn't a little lady, you know?
No, she's not.
Right.
She did that windmill dance, remember?
Yeah, exactly. It was like three legs going across the stage. And one other thing that's really great is she had that red afro wig on, and in this instance the curtains matched the drapes because Peggy was, you know, Matthew was a ginger down there.
I love you tomorrow.
Hey Timmy, do you have any remembrances of Peggy either from on stage or the book club?
Oh yeah, well the book club. By the way, you guys can see I'm at my cabin. Do you guys see trees and stuff?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do. Yeah.
Okay.
You were building
Oh, shit. Don't say that. The fire department will come down here.
Yeah.
But you know what's funny is I forget how many years ago first, we actually had a cabin book club. And Peggy came to that cabin book club. I remember she bought magnolias and we planted them out here. And it was on the fall equinox, which, you know, just happened yesterday. So it's almost like an anniversary of that. So that was probably maybe 5 years ago. I forget. But one other thing I wanted to say besides the cabin was we had a book club. I think it was at Mar and Corey's house. And I forget, we might have read Going Clear, but, you know, in a book club, probably if you're not familiar with it, everybody says what they thought about the book, and everybody has a little bit of a check-in. And, you know, I was listening to Peggy's check-in, and then by the time she was done her check-in, I looked at her and I said, Peggy, can I ask you a question? And she goes, sure. I go, what was the title of the book you read? So that's my memory of our book club, and I hope that's okay with everybody.
So she had read a different book. That's what had happened, huh?
No, I think what he's saying is she had read the same book, but just had interpreted it totally differently.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah. No, it was the same book. It was just like, okay. Yeah. So no, that's what it was. That was Peggy.
Yeah. Okay, Corey, you've known Peggy a long time. Do you have any stories you'd like to share?
Yeah, I have two quick ones. Like Elizabeth, I met Peggy for the first time at Midnight Mass, only it was a different show. She did Poltergeist, in which she played psychic medium Tangina. And she delivered this fantastic monologue about crossing over to the other side and meeting Carol Ann. It's a very long monologue. And she came in and she started the monologue and it sort of went on and on and on. And she lost her place. And she adjusted her shoes on stage and just started the whole thing over again. And the audience just went crazy.
Yeah.
She was not a confident performer. It was one of the funniest things I've ever seen anybody do live. The second thing is Peggy and I sort of had a bond because as Joshua and Michael will attest, I can sometimes do sort of dingbatty, clumsy things. When we had our book club in San Francisco, she came over for, I forget what the book was, but Michael had recently installed a bidet in the bathroom. I know, don't blush. And, you know, we didn't really explain that it was there, but knowing Peggy and knowing that, you know, there was maybe a chance that something crazy would happen, we just sort of let it lie. And sure enough, about three quarters of the way and a couple of bottles of wine into the book club, she went up, got up to use the bathroom. And within minutes, there was a loud shriek. And she had turned it on while standing up and facing the toilet. So she got sprayed in the face and she walked out and she was just like, it was like a wet t-shirt contest. But because she was so gracious, totally had a good sense of humor about it and gave us a funny story. And that's kind of like who she was. I think she was just, you know, always up for a good time and always very kind. And I already miss her a lot.
Yeah. All right. Michael, last but not least.
Well, I guess I have seen Peggy do shows ever since Viva Variety. And I was always a big fan of hers. And so it was exciting for me to do shows with her because I think she's just so dynamic and so fun to sort of be a clown with. But I think my favorite day, one of my favorite days of my whole life, I got to spend with Peggy was when Peaches and Jinx were doing Grey Gardens. And Peggy had somehow signed me up to sell tickets for this show, which was a double feature. So that meant we were going to be in the Castro Theater box office for like, I don't know, 20 hours or something like that. Some extraordinary amount of time that we couldn't ever leave, and we'd be like, they would like lock us in this little box.
No food, no water.
So Peggy was like, oh, I think we should dress up. And I thought, all right, you know, I guess we'll, you know, put a scarf on or something. But she was fully committed to being Little Edie, and not Little Edie and Big Edie, but what would only be funny is if there were only Little Edies, like a whole box office full of Little Edies. And so I spent the entire day with a magnifying glass looking at people and being Little Edie for 20 hours with Peggy. and it was probably one of the funnest days I've ever had in my entire life.
Oh, that's so great. One thing about Peggy and you, which I still to this day don't know if it was Peggy intentionally doing this or not, but she would never call you Martini. For like 20 years, she'd be like, Martin, Martini, what's her name? And like, to the point where I'm like, I think she really doesn't know.
It was very Endora from Bewitched. Like, I was like Durwood. And, yeah.
It was very Edna Garrett.
One of the things that her brother found when they were cleaning out her apartment was a stack of old Midnight Mass and Peaches Christ scripts. And one of them was from Poltergeist. And you had signed her script, Martini. Don't remember this. I'll take a picture of it and send it to you. But you basically say, please stop forgetting my name. And that was probably from 20 years ago. Oh.
Well, anyways. She never knew it.
I know. I wonder. Yeah, exactly. But she was like that with everybody. I don't think she could, you know, she would forget anybody's name, you know, which I loved. I mean, she was a brilliant dingbat, you know, and we just loved her so, so much. And I'm glad that she got to be part of so many different, you know, parts of our lives, including this book club, which I've always found to be a really intimate, special way for us to share friendship. So this Fierce Read book club will miss her. That's for sure.
Yep, that's for sure.
Yeah. So thank you guys. And we will get back to the memorial.
Okay. Thank you, Josh. Bye.
Okay.
Wow. What a bunch of nerds. That was really long and gratuitous. We actually sat through that. Yes, you tricked me. You were in that book club. You're a nerd, Peaches.
What are you talking about?
That was you, Joshua All right. Grinnell.
Well, moving right along, one of the things that I really, really loved with my friendship with Peggy was actually seeing her more than once at the Hypnodrome, performing with the fantastic Thrill Peddlers. And we now have Russell Blackwood, who's going to speak some about Peggy, but also included in this is one of her fantastic numbers.
Hello, I'm Russell Blackwood. 5 years ago, I had the great pleasure of presenting Peggy L'eggs at the Hypnodrome, descending into the nine circles of hell in the glam rock musical Club Inferno. She was Inferno's classic character Dante, reimagined as a pop icon who's falling fast.
Matthew was a brilliant addition to Thrill Peddler's theater ensemble, and I found him to be a cherished friend and sage. I imagine many of you would agree. Here's our Peggy leading the Club Inferno finale, Reach for the Stars.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Yes. And we're just going to keep moving right along because we have so much content to share with you.
We're not going
to
talk anymore. Give it up.
Well, I'm sorry I was thrown that time because every other time Sean Frank has warned us that we were about to go back on, and this time there was nothing. Sorry. So we just sort of, you know, saw ourselves there, and
okay.
Here we are.
All right. Well, I don't know what to say about this next performer, and I mean that because I've never heard of her before. So you, why don't you introduce them, Peaches?
Well, one of the things, again, in the giant life that Peggy L'eggs led, she was part of so many different theater communities and had so many different groups of friends that one time she said, have you ever heard of panto, the British tradition of theater style that it is really popular in the UK? And I said, yes, because I know a thing or two. And she invited me to a panto show at the Marine Memorial Theater. And there I went, and there she was doing panto with a whole group of people I had never met before. So speaking about the Panto SF group that Peggy was a major member of is Patricia Miller.
Once upon a time, there was a little theater company in San Francisco called Panto SF and a self-producing theater director called Patricia Miller. If you're sitting comfortably, I'll tell you the story. The elves and the fae tell all the good little girls, like me, that the radical fairies give great gifts. And so it was for me and Panto SF. I met our beloved Matthew at a Generate gathering, thank you, Ed Wolf, and we were volunteering to cut up all the vegetables and I was in charge. Peggy had just killed it on stage the night before at the talent show, but her talent does not extend to broccoli preparation, and we both caught a lot of shit. I wasn't invited back. It was chaos. But you know Matthew, it was hilarious. 2 weeks later, he was auditioning in my living room for my star player, the Pantomime Dame. What is panto, I hear you ask? Matthew and I both shared a time growing up in the London suburb near Chorleywood in Hertfordshire, and we shared a love of the bawdy, family-friendly Christmas extravaganza that is panto. My company was young, self-produced, badly funded, and yet Matthew and Peggy sashayed into the dame role tradition, which was shared by 19th century vaudeville comics and Sir Ian McKellen alike. She played the villainess, the furious Maleficent, and of course the evil stepmother of Cinderella, the Baron von Cumberbatch, over 5 glorious Christmas seasons, all the time still working with many of you on your shows, running from theater to theater, which was her way. She brought glamour, style, and unbeatable wit to my script. She brought a fake leg from Macy's. Her comic timing was impeccable as she surveyed the audience of all ages and all backgrounds and encouraged them to boo and hiss as she emotionally tortured the poor little lady leads and the macho handsome princes. You would have loved it. With Matthew's help, our cast grew to include Laval Cocoa Butter, Elsa Touche, the lovely Jason Brock, and the talented kitten on the keys. Last week, we lost a star in the sky and a star on the stage. And I'm not alone in saying a friend, a fierce colleague who just never let up, who worked her lovely pins off backstage and on stage. She choreographed, she supported new queens, she supported young performers. She supported a young producer and me. Matthew Simmons, you're my muse. And Christmas will never be the same without you. Here she is bringing down the house at the Marines Memorial as the Baron von Cumberbatch doing her rendition of The Dying Swan. I love you, Matthew.
Yeah.
That was gorgeous. Give it up for Patricia Miller from Panto SF. Isn't that nice, Peaches?
It was great. And I actually got to see Peggy in a few of those shows. And Panto was perfect for Peggy in so many ways, because much like our shows, you know, when we did the Midnight Mass shows and then the shows at the Castro Theater, the audience was encouraged to, you know, engage with the actors. And so she could, you know, like really go rogue and be crazy. And, you know, everyone loved it, especially when she was a villain.
Now we have somebody from an organization that, just like Peggy L'eggs, has done a lot of great work for a lot of people. The organization was founded here in San Francisco and, of course, now has, let's say, chapters? Clusters?
Yeah, they have orders.
Orders all around the world. Mm-hmm. Give it up from the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence. It is Sister Mary Peter.
Hey, everyone. My name is Sister Mary Peter of the San Francisco Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence. And I'm grateful for this chance to remember my friend, Peggy L'eggs, Matthew. Very early on when I was thinking of becoming a nun, it was Matthew who gave me the courage to move forward with my vocation. When I wasn't sure how this would all come together, he looked at me one day and said, "Well, I guess you just need to figure out what a nun does and then walk out the door and do it, girl." And from that moment, his generosity and kindness and support guided me in my chosen vocation. And his joy will always be a part of my heart. I offer this meditation as a blessing on his spirit and his journey, on their joyful celebration of life, and in gratitude for all the lives that Peggy touched. It's a memory of our time together in Toronto. The Queen is dead. Long live the Queen. Fuck, I miss you, bitch. Like I miss the early 90s, that beat, that sweat, the sense of hard-won victory just around the corner, so close you could taste it. Like sex, when you got off the ferry to Hanlon's Point on Canada Day or Pride Weekend. The way you read a queen with such kindness that she ended up saying, "Thank you, bitch," without even a drop of irony. The way you sang the body electric loud, like Ethel Merman on acid getting rimmed by Mae West, silently conducting the current pulsing through your fingertips. The way you rat fucked and teased those wigs and teased me, a basic booga drag hoe, shoving me into pumps and parading me around like some wobbly Princess Margaret. You beat my face so hard, Peggy, you could see the outline of Jesus in it, like on a piece of burnt toast or a wet burrito. You loved cottaging on the lake, oh, but your ocean called you back. No matter how charming we were with all of our so sorries, eh? Your passions meant to play out on the seven sacred hills of San Francisco. Viva variety, you cried, bound for the oasis, your little tranny shack, your favorite stud. Imagine my surprise when all those years later, after all my protests, I moved here too. You didn't clutch your pearls. You showed up for me. Or rather, Peggy L'eggs did. Pink from head to toe, like a freshly loofah Jackie O, welcoming me to the hood. You, a thirsty Revlon girl, eager to close another sale. You'll just love it here. Just give it some time. They're really nice people once you get to know them. I didn't always believe you. I still don't. But I never, never doubted your kindness. Viva variety. Viva Peggy L'eggs. Rest in glamour. Rise in power. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Thank you, Sister Mary Peter.
That was beautiful.
Very poignant. Well, now, Peaches, did you know, you know that we're here in Oasis right now.
Yes.
And did you know that Peggy did a lot of things here at Oasis?
I did. I actually saw her in a lot of things here.
So she was in The Facts of Life.
As Mrs. Garrett, of course.
As Mrs. G, yes. Yeah. And she was in Ab Fab.
Yes.
She was in, am I correct? She was in Cyberotica?
Cyberotica.
She, one time, I worked with her here in this room when she was hosting Out Loud.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I Out Loud was a very special thing that Peggy really loved. It was a storytelling show that we used to do right here on this stage. And actually, when I couldn't do it any longer, Peggy took over for me with Tommy Salami as producers of the show.
She also did a lot of shows with Drunk Drag Broadway, which... this is a great segue.
Mm-hmm.
Our next guests. Give it up for Drunk Drag Broadway.
And China Make It, who's here in person. Heklina and I are going to go over this way and make some room, and then China's going to appear.
Thank you, Peaches and Heklina. Peggy L'eggs. Ugh. I first met Peggy when I was doing I was a dancing bear for a Folsom video that was very Bob Fosse style. It was this big, fabulous video that we did, and Peggy came in with that big blonde ponytail, and she kicked those legs up to the sky, and I said, I have to know this bitch. It was magical and incredible and gorgeous, and I was like, I need to know her, and she was a star of this video, and I was just dancing bear number 4, and she was kind to me and loving and sweet. I then got a chance to perform with Peggy in Cyberotica here at Oasis. We actually had a very intimate relationship on stage. If you saw that show, you know what I mean. If you didn't, you're lucky. We had a great relationship there. Peggy was the person who backstage kept the drag drama on stage and kept the human heart backstage. And that's something that I believe that we all need. And I invited Peggy to be part of Drunk Drag Broadway. And the first thing she ever did with us was a number called Tenderloin Stripper for one of our cabaret shows. I then was like, Peggy, you're a star. You need to be hosting this with me. And we were narrators for the Drunk Drag Disney on Broadway. Not only that, but she co-wrote the show with me. So to sit with Matthew for hours and write a parody show and go into that twisted, crazy, insane, wonderful mind of Matthew's and develop jokes and have Peggy speak the words that were coming out of my mouth, it was such a treat, inspiring, fabulous, delicious, and I really instantly felt like, oh, I have a new friend. I have a new person in this community who cares about me, who's real. And Peggy gave that to so many of us, and I got to sit backstage with Peggy getting ready. She taught me that super glue works better for the nails than that bullshit nail glue that we have, and told me all these fabulous, amazing stories of performing past and seeing the show and all the amazing contributions Peggy's made. I'm honored that I got to sit next to her on stage and narrate a show. I'm honored that we got to be friends backstage. I wish it was for much, much longer. So as a tribute to Peggy, our Drunk Drag Broadway family put together a parody number of her original lyrics of Tenderloin Stripper, a parody of Broadway Baby. And with that, I present to you our tribute to Peggy L'eggs from Drunk Drag Broadway with love.
Just a tenderloin stripper, walking off my tired feet, pounding gear in Larkin Street
to be in a show. Oh,
tenderloin stripper,
learning how to bump and grind,
showing off my fat behind
to be in a show. Oh,
gee, I'd like to be on some marquee, all twinkling lights,
a spark to pierce the dark,
from Golden Gate Park
to Alamo Square.
Someday maybe
my dreams will be repaid.
Heck, I'd even fuck the trait
to be in a show.
Hey, Mr. Producer,
I'm talking to you, sir.
I don't need a lot, only what I got.
Plus a tube of lubricant and a follow spot.
I'm a tenderloin stripper,
slaving at the Taco Bell, dreaming of a great day when
I'll be in a show.
Tenderloin stripper,
making rounds all afternoon,
eating at a greasy spoon to save on my dough.
Oh, at my tiny flat,
there's just my cat,
a bed and a chair.
Still, I'll stick it till I'm on the bill.
All over SF.
Someday, maybe.
To strut my stuff,
working for a nice man like Arnie Mitchell
in a
great big
China and Drunk Drag Broadway. That
everyone who participated in that was fabulous. Oh my God. Yeah, I mean, it just, it really brings to light just how many stages across the city that Peggy performed on. I actually wonder, maybe she broke the record.
Well, this is a good segue to the next clip we're going to see right now. So, Peggy was in a rock band called Pepper Spray, and they performed all around town at the Castor Street Fair, the Folsom Street Fair, and maybe you remember, they opened once for Cher.
I remember they opened for the Cher.
At the Concord Pavilion. I was there myself.
Oh, were you?
Yes.
Well,
and,
that's nice.
Yeah.
I mean, that really makes it special.
I was on the Pepper Spray guest list.
Wow.
I know.
Well, the Pepper Spray group, of course, were made up of fantastic friends of ours. Peter Fogel, Michael Soldier, Princess Kennedy, and Jordan L'Amour. And speaking on behalf of Pepper Spray is the fantastic Jordan L'Amour. And this will be followed by a number by Pepper Spray.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jordan L'Amour, and I have been asked to say a few words about Peggy L'eggs on behalf of her band Pepper Spray. I know many people will talk about Peggy's kindness and how sweet she was, but I would just kind of like to focus right now on what a wonderful musician she was. Peggy was our principal keyboardist and a quarter of our lead singers. And she was wonderful at both. When she was playing piano, she never wanted to do the easy way, and she always wanted to show as much range as she could. I remember one of the only times that she ever really, truly had a meltdown in rehearsal was after Peter had asked her to simplify one of the parts that she was doing on one of our songs, and they were having a big back and forth, and the whole band was just watching this happening, and they were really arguing, and finally she just kind of put her fist out and was like, "I will not be relegated to chords." At that moment, we all went silent, and then we just all burst into laughter. And of course, Peggy was laughing the loudest of all of us. Even when she was upset, she never took herself too seriously. One funny thing during her time in the band was her constant, unending desire to perform the song Little Bird by Annie Lennox, which we all thought was terribly inappropriate for our hard rock punk band. You know, we would shoot it down, and then she would always come back with something like, "Well, then how about the Neutron Dance by the Pointer Sisters?" And we would be like, "No, Peggy, no, that's not punk." And she'd be like, what? It is punk. Anyway, we all thought that was just hilarious and kind of still do. Peggy was an incredibly generous person. She made countless flyers for us. She did costume pieces, helped with wigs. At one point, she even hand-sewed beautiful satin pillows for everybody in the band. This one is mine. And you can see she put in beautiful beads and little bells. And I mean, it was just gorgeous. I've always cherished it. And it's just so hard to know that she's not here anymore. The last time we talked, we were plotting about maybe getting the band back together if COVID was ever over. And she had lost the ability to play piano because of a hand condition. But of course, in Peggy fashion, she didn't let it get her down. She was just bravely talking about, you know, after surgery, she would probably be able to play again. And until then, you know, I was gonna have to learn how to do all of those parts, which that was hilarious because we all know it would not have sounded the same. We joked about finally doing the Neutron Dance and maybe even doing a whole show set piece about the Neutron Dance. I just kind of want to wrap it up by mentioning one last thing about Peggy that I really admired. And she had this ability to deeply connect with people almost instantly. And one time we were at Pride, we were playing the main stage, and we were backstage, and Armistead Maupin and Laura Linney happened to be there. And so, of course, we were all excited, and we went to take pictures with them, and we did that, and I went back to the dressing room and left her there. And we were about to go on stage, and we realized that Peggy wasn't with us, and we didn't know where she was. And so, you know, we went running around backstage looking for her, and there she was, like, locked in this deep, soul-crushing embrace with Laura Linney. You could tell they were having such a wonderful conversation, and Laura was just looking up at her with this look of adoration in her eyes, and you could just tell that she'd completely fallen in love with our Peggy. It was easy to fall in love with Peggy. She was such a sweetheart. We're gonna miss her so much. On behalf of the whole band, I just wanna say how heartbroken we are, but also that we are really thankful that we had the chance to create music with her and to have so many wonderful times and laughter. Fly free, little bird. Fly free.
Yay, pepper spray!
Oh my God, it's so funny to see Peggy L'eggs try and be rock and roll. It's like seeing your elementary school teacher up there trying to be punk rock.
Oh my God.
She was always wearing her glasses like over the keyboards and stuff. It was like, again, your drag auntie, and I just love that about her.
The reality of it is, though, that Peggy, you know, behind the scenes was punk rock, you know. And if you doubt that at all, check out that obituary in the Bay Area Reporter, where some of you may not know, but Peggy was part of the group Body Electric. And, you know, would work to help other men who were sick and dying and actually provide sexual services. And at one point in this obituary, one of her friends talks about, you know, running into Peggy or Matthew and saying, you know, how are you? What did you do? And she says, I just fucked AIDS. That is fucking punk rock. That is punk rock. You know, and so when remembering Peggy, it's easy, I feel like, we love to tease Peggy. I mean, that was the other thing. We, as drag performers, Heklina and I especially, show our affection and our love through teasing people we love.
She was a little bit of a ditz, but I loved that about her. And what I really loved about Peggy was she was never afraid to bomb. She was so locked into her vision of what she wanted to do. A lot of times we did corporate gigs together. And she would do something in front of these like corporate crowds that she knew was not going to go over. And she would do it anyway. And you know, people would just stand there with their mouths open and there no applause or anything. And she kind of didn't give a fuck.
No.
So I think that is very punk rock also.
Yeah, she just was, for such a loving, generous, sweet, silly person on stage, Matthew was, you know, complicated and generous. And I mean, it's cheesy to say, but like, I feel like Matthew was sort of like an angel in some ways because of the work that he did to support those of us who needed support, myself included. You know, this was a person who was just strength personified and pure love.
Well, I'm glad I can be that person for you now, Peaches.
Now, I want to introduce our next speaker. Who knew Matthew very well from the Shanti Project. No, Heklina, you are that person for me.
I love how it took a minute.
I was like, I'll give her that. but I want to introduce our next speaker, which is Tina Garcia Jr., who worked with Peggy at the Shanti Project.
Hi, my name is Tina Aguirre. Let me start out by thanking Peaches Christ, Heklina, and Kylie Minono for organizing this memorial. I worked with Matthew Simmons at the Shanti Project, where he started in 2010 and I started in 2012. He was the manager of the LIFE program, a program for people living with HIV, until 2016 when he started as a care navigator for the LASSEN program, where eventually he became the manager. LASSEN program is Shanti services for LGBTQ older adults and adults with disabilities. And what Matthew brought to this was, of course, compassion, understanding, and levity. An example of this is when Kylie Minono and myself encouraged a friend of ours, Fred Townsend, to get some support after he had a foot amputated due to complications related to diabetes. He doesn't like to complain. And asking for help is hard. He did eventually relent and he connected with Matthew, who was fabulous with Fred. He helped Fred to get VFW, Veteran of Foreign War benefits from the VA, which was an increase from what he was getting before. And after that, Fred was able to save money and apply for housing. Eventually, he got into the new building operated by Open House. This weekend, he celebrated his 1-year anniversary there. He called me about Matthew's passing to share that he was sad, but also happy with all of the really great connections, conversations, all of the experiences that he had with Matthew, and that he wanted to make a donation to Shanti in his honor, which for me exemplifies how Matthew's impact left many of us wanting to give back to our community. On a personal note, we had a lot of fun together. In 2017, we traveled to New York City to see theatrical shows. We saw Hello Dolly with Bette Midler. We saw Patti LuPone in war paint, front row seats. And we saw a really gory, fabulously immersive Sweeney Todd show. I think that for me helped Matthew splurge a little more. Or at least I could see that in him afterward, that he started to enjoy life. He went on a cruise to Alaska, and it just makes me happy to know that we had those experiences. Another one I can share with you is that at a gala for Shanti, there was a model who was wearing a Vera Wang dress. And the Vera Wang dress was awesome. So Matthew and I kind of orbited around her for a while, just in awe. And at some point the dress started to have tulle droppings, pieces of the dress made out of tulle that were falling on the floor. What we did was promptly collect them and then offer them back to the model, who let us know she was absolutely not gonna sew those back on the dress and that we could keep them. So we were kind of shocked, but also really happy because we had Vera Wang remnants. We became the Vera Wang sisters. And to this day, I cherish this Vera Wang remnant. Finally, my message is really for Matthew. I know that you're on the other side, getting ready for a great show. And I can't wait to get there so that I can join you in the front row, applauding and showing you my love. I miss you and I love you, Matthew Simmons. Thank you.
Tina Garcia.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Tina Garcia has always been so supportive of Oasis, and everybody, it's so great to hear her speak about Peggy and Shanti. And again, you can donate to Shanti. We have that link here. There we go. Thank you so much, Sean Frank. So it's just easier to take a screenshot of that because there's a forward slash and a dash and a dot and all that stuff. Anyway, it's shanti.org/Matthew Simmons-Simmons. It's shanti.org/Matthew-Simmons. Huh?
We'll post it in the chat.
Thank you so much. Anyway, now it's time for somebody very special. Everyone's been special. But during Tina's speech, Peaches and I were trying to remember what year this next performer won the Miss Tranny Shack pageant. And since I ran Tranny Shack, I really should know. But
you
I
should.
Don't. It's been a long time.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say it was either 2004 or 2005 that she walked away with the title of Miss Tranny Shack. And she is such a brilliant performer. And she has something very special in Peggy's honor. Please give it up for Rhea Light.
We're going to close the show with one of our favorites, our perennial favorites here. Most of the people who have been here know who she is. She's done everything from comedy, broad comedy, slapstick, to dance, to the classics. Please give a warm welcome to the irrevocably damaged Peggy L'eggs.
Ew, you're on.
Oh, I'm on? Just give me a minute.
Some moments that I've had, some moments of pleasure. Diving stop laughing. This sense of humor of mine, it isn't funny at all. Oh, but we sit up all night talking about it.
Raya, light.
That was gorgeous.
So great. Raya, we were just saying, China mentioned that Raya, there are performers and then there are artists. And Raya is definitely an artist. And I know, being close with both Raya and Peggy, how much Peggy meant to Raya. Raya absolutely admired Peggy. And last year, when the two of them shared a role together in Terror Vault, it was pretty amazing. Watching Raya, you know, take the direction from Peggy on how to be this cannibalistic grandmother. And they both took it so seriously, even though it was the most ludicrous thing you could ever imagine. Well, we're nearing the end of this beautiful memorial. And one of the things that was really important to us when we were putting it together was that tonight is merely the beginning of continuing to honor Peggy and her memory. And with that, our next speakers would like to talk more about how we can do that. They have a fantastic idea and they need your help. It's gonna be a community effort. So the two people I'm gonna bring up have been close friends of mine for a while now, and we're both a big part and very supportive of the Out Loud Storytelling series that Peggy was a part of with me. In fact, Tommy was one of our co-hosts and co-producers, and Alexa would come every time we did a show. We love them both, and they're here. They're going to speak about what they have in store for us. Heklina and I are going to move that way, and they're going to come up this way. We have this all mapped out. It's a whole choreographed thing. So let's hear it for Alexa Frazier-Heron and Tommy Salami.
All right, we're going to socially distance now.
Yeah, we're going to go over here.
We're moving this way.
Yep.
Hey everybody, I'm Alexa.
And I'm Tommy.
And we didn't rehearse.
No. I felt it was better to just go ahead and speak from my heart, because that's what Peggy always did. You always got the unfiltered by anything but his own pure love for all of us. That you meet very few people in your life who are pure love, who radiate love and service and care for everyone they know and everything they do. And he did everything and loved all of us like it was his goddamn job. I'll never forget, I met Peggy when I was doing Club Inferno, the performance we saw earlier, playing drums for a wonderful musical by Peter Fogel and Kelly Cattell, and I fell in love with Peggy instantly. I remember the first, I think it was the night the show opened, Lee Crow, Jen Gandy, and Leslie Einhorn were up in the dressing room, and I came to change out of my sweaty band clothes, and Lee Crow said, "Ooh, Tommy's got a crush on Peggy." And I turned around and said, "Yeah, absolutely. How can you not? What an incredible person. What a sweetheart." And we became good friends over the years. And so when Joshua asked us to step in and start helping out with Out Loud, we were overjoyed. It was just a more time that we could spend together making each other laugh. Nobody ever made me laugh as hard as Peggy did, and as often. Some people know this, not everybody knows this, but when I changed my name legally, Peggy came with me, took a day off work, and came with me to the Oakland Courthouse, Alameda County Courthouse, and sat next to me, wore a bow tie, sat next to me and held my hand until they called my new name. And then he called me Junior ever after that, and I called him Margaret because he's a nice Midwestern Catholic lady. And I have an aunt named Peggy whose name is Margaret, and it just sort of stuck. And so, when it came to doing Out Loud, the even better for me than doing the shows was going and recording the bumpers and the introductions to the shows, because it meant Joshua and Matthew and I and Steve Bollinger, our sound producer engineer, got to sit around and joke around for a few hours. And I look back on those hours as some of the most free and joyful of my life. And that when we found out what had occurred, Alexa reached out and said, "We should do a zine." And I said, "That sounds like an incredible idea." Do you want to talk a little bit about?
Sure. So I've known Peggy for years. I met her through Peaches Christ Productions, where I was a production manager for a couple of years. We had my sister, Nicole, who's up in the comments as Elephant Infantry, was around a lot taking photos of our productions. And it was just so quick and easy, like, to like fall in love with Peggy. I think that comes as a surprise to no one. We were kind of unofficial drag daughters, my sister and I, of Peggy. She was Mama Legs to us. She always wanted to get us in drag. Ultimately, when I did get in drag, it was Vanilla Meringue that put me in face. So that kind of makes Vanilla my sister. I'm her sister and her daughter, I think, is if you want to be Chinatown about it. So I am Vanilla Meringue's sister and her daughter. We have the Mama Legs connection. And I just, losing someone you love is really hard, and losing them now. If you know me, you knew this was coming, that I'd cry. But I don't know, I think that this isn't like Heklina crying, sorry.
It's real.
This is some real shit. I just was so comforted by everyone's stories and photos. Fuck. I literally waited till the last minute to put mascara on because I've been spending so much of this memorial crying. I thought I had it out of me. But at any rate, so I just was so inspired, and there was something about Tommy's post. You were posting about the about Matthew going to court with you, and then you had a really wonderful story. Such a gentleman, thank you. You had this great story about how you went over to care for Matthew after one of his surgeries, and he got you to caulk his bathtub and was super loopy on meds, and so while you're working on the tub...
Standing in the doorway while I'm caulking the bathtub, singing, "It's so nice to have a man around the house."
So all that to say, there really is nothing like a Peggy L'eggs story, and I just really... feel like social media is a necessary evil, especially now, to like stay connected to our friends. And in seeing all this beautiful like outpouring for Matthew and for Peggy, I just really wanted a place to keep all this that was independent of social media, something that I can hold in my hands. And I thought that if I wanted that other people would want it too. So I started with you. I reached out to Tommy and said, like, I think I just shot it off, like, man, now I want to make a zine. And he was like, that's great, let's talk. And so we are now, we're putting out the call. It's happening right now.
I've been chatting to some of you.
Yes, up in the comments.
In the chat there is Leshy of the Woods, and throwing out the email address that we're using, which is foreverpeggylegs@gmail.com.
Yeah, so what we need from you is just anything you want to give, whether it's photos, stories, I've seen art, I know I want to make some art, like anything you want, like you can write to Peggy if you have things that you want to say and you're having trouble saying them, still reach out to us, and we'll figure it out.
I'm very good at facilitating a story.
Yes. And if you feel moved, like maybe you want to like actually design a full page layout, like if anyone was into yearbooks or zine making, we want to hear from you. So yeah, the email address is the best way to get a hold of us. Both Tommy and I are there at foreverpeggylegs@gmail.com. And my sister Nicole, again, she's in the comments, is Elephant Infantry. She took the photo of Peggy on the stairs that I bastardized with a filter just to get the zine idea across to you guys. She actually took two of her most popular images and is making prints. Just, she never sells her work, but because of the outpouring of love and people wanting to see, to have a copy of these prints, she's doing a very limited run. And the URL is right below me, tiny.cc/legsforever. And that's all I got.
Well, and the proceeds from the...
So we're only going to be charging roughly for cost, and anything left over is probably going to be for Shanti. This is a labor of love. I'm just going to pay for the printing costs up front. So, I mean, ultimately, this is in the beginning stages, so I haven't talked to Shanti yet, but I feel like that's a no-brainer.
I feel like they'll be open to it.
That's a no-brainer, yeah, so... the zine will be like 5.5 by 8.5, perfect bound, full color. So just please reach out to us if you have rad stuff to share. We really want to hear from you. And
yeah, and in any format. We're also going to be exploring having it exist as a digital archive. So video, audio recordings, anything you have that you think would be of interest. We're looking at trying to archive as many of these memories as we can for the future.
Thank you. Love to you all. Take care.
Oh, and one more thing before we go off. I just want to remind everybody of the shared joke that I'm pretty sure Peggy L'eggs had with all of us of her Taylor Dane musical, Don't Rush Me, the Taylor Dane story, which could change with any. Love Will Lead You Back, the Taylor Dane story. My favorite. Let's get out of here.
Thank you, Tommy and Alexa. And we really look forward to the zine, both the physical version and the online version. And yeah, this is, we're wrapping up the memorial. I know Heklina and I really wanted to do this fairly quickly. I got the news about Peggy's passing. Actually, Tina and Kylie called me and on the night that she was found. And I have to say that since then, it's only made a very surreal and awful year more surreal. I wake up every morning and the first thing I think is Peggy really gone? So I know that for myself and people who loved her, we're gonna be processing this and talking about it for a long time. And the fact that we can't be together in person makes it even more challenging. So as cheesy as it is to say, like, check in on your friends, let's check in on each other, contact each other. And this isn't over tonight. Well, we're going to be continuing with some things this evening, like the reception that Kylie's hosting. And I also wanted to say that Matthew, Peggy loved Out Loud so much that I would like to bring it back. And so I'm going to talk to Tommy and do a virtual Out Loud storytelling where the stories and the theme of the night is Peggy. You know, so that we can have more stories about Peggy and do another night in the next coming months. Lastly, I'm going to mention that Peggy was in so many of my shows that I actually tried to count them for tonight, and I lost track because I would keep thinking of another one and another one. But one of my favorite roles, there were three that stood out. Annie, her Tangina in Poltergeist was one of my favorites, and then her Fellatio Alden in our Witches of East Bay show. And so after I'd heard about this, I've been tossing around the idea of doing online screenings of our Castro Theater shows, and I decided that the first one needs to be dedicated to Peggy, and I called Chad Michaels and Coco Peru, who are distraught and upset over the loss of Peggy. We actually got to travel that show to New York all together. And we all love Peggy. And so next Thursday, October 1st, we're gonna be doing a screening hosted by Chad, Coco, and myself of The Witches of East Bay. And if you want to see a Peggy performance, you know, I mean, it's a typical Peggy performance. She really steals the show, and she gets to vomit cherries and spray diarrhea all over Jerry Lee. So I know you're going to want to tune in for that, and you can grab a ticket at peacheschrist.live. Heklina, do you have any final words?
Well, I just want to say, I want to echo a lot of what Peaches just said. Peggy was such a special person, and one of those people, now that she's gone, that I just wish I would have reached out to more often and been more in her life, you know what I mean? Like, I really feel like I missed somebody very special, because I did not reach out to her enough. And so I just treasure the memories of when I did work with her. And what a unique person, and how she, you know, a lot of people help make San Francisco so special, and she really did make San Francisco unique and special. And I wanna, one way you can tell all the love for Peggy is all the work that went into this memorial and how we were able to turn it around so quickly. And that is a lot of the work behind the scenes. So I really wanna thank I want to thank China Make It. I want to thank Sean Frank. You know, like, there was no real glitches or fuck-ups, which, you know, that means a lot of work has gone into it behind the scenes, which is great. Am I forgetting to thank anybody?
Well, we want to thank Oasis for hosting us, yes, of course. And I'm sure we're forgetting people, everyone who contributed. And again, we are going to end the show right now with a montage that the wonderful Andrew Slade has put together. Of a lot of people's photos and videos And following the montage, if you don't see it in the chat, is going to be the URL for the reception that is being held and hosted by Kylie Minogue. So we're hoping that loads of you will jump over to that, where you can continue to share your stories. It's going to be on Zoom, so you guys can see each other and engage. And finally, I mean, I think I can speak for Heklina as well. Really, ultimately, like, we want to do something in person. So, you know, in the future, it's a shame. It is so upsetting that we are not at the Castro Theater right now or the Victoria Theater sitting together and doing this in person. So this will have to be for now. But when we can be together again, I would love to throw a Peggy party and do some of this stuff on stage and in person. So we'll do that when it's safe for us all to gather again. But hang in there and take care of each other. I love you, Heklina.
I love you too, Peaches.
Yeah, this is...
And yeah, this was very... I found my heart. I found it. Mm-hmm. It's here.
Yeah.
I miss you, Peggy. And thank you, everybody, so much for contributing and all the work once again for this beautiful memorial. I will say that when Peggy did pass away, you know, it falls onto Peaches and I a lot of times to throw things together. Somebody suggested a digital memorial immediately, and I was like, no, we have to do something live. But yeah, it's like Peaches said, we're just not able to. So yes, I'll come up from Palm Springs as soon as we can do a live show, because that's really what she would love.
Yeah. All right, take care and enjoy this final video by Chaka Khan / Andrew Slade.
Mwah. Chaka Corn.
Oh, Chaka Corn. No glitches, and I fuck it up right at the end. Chaka Khan did not make this video. Chaka Corn made this video.
Yes.
Oh my God, that was such a Peggy thing to do. All right, good night.
Good night.
So still, shh, shh, you're all alone, shh, shh, and so peaceful until you fall in love, simple, the sky up above, simple, is caving in. Wow, you never been so nuts about a guy you wanna love, you wanna cry, you crush your heart and hope to die till it's over, and then shh, shh, it's nice and quiet, shh, shh, but soon again, shh, shh, starts another big riot. You blow a fuse, simple, the devil cuts loose, simple, so what's the use? Wow! Of falling in love. It's oh so quiet. Riot, you blow a fuse.
It's bigger than us, it's bigger than everything. And so we drink. The rich have the rituals. We got bills and visuals. We're more beautiful. We're more unusual. Don't look back, don't be afraid. Don't you ever, ever change. You're more beautiful when you're unusual. 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 Unusual.
Thank you.